Lord, God's children, because this is a day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. Welcome to the Master's Touch worship service for Sunday. We're delighted to be able to bring these worship services to you to glorify God. Now, as we begin our worship today, take a second to assemble a small piece of bread or cracker or something that you're going to use, a piece of fruit or something, and some sort of a beverage to swallow, just a swallow of it. And set it aside for later on, because we're going to pray over it, sanctify it as the body and the blood of Christ. But right now, let's begin by inviting the Holy Spirit to join us in our worship service, shall we? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come into your presence in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. We enter your courts with praise and thanksgiving in our hearts, just open wide, expecting to receive your word and revelation knowledge. Our love and devotion for you flows freely from our lips. We love you, we magnify you and adore you, and we praise your precious holy name. We thank you and praise you that we believers, dwell in the secret place of the Most High, and we thank you that you've already heard our prayers. We rejoice because your word tells us that all the answers for the believers' prayers are yes and amen. We thank you for the gifts of utterance, the rhema word of God, and revelation knowledge, and we thank you that the healing power of God is present to heal all who come to you in faith and in need. We give you thanks and praise for your only begotten Son and his finished work on the cross on our behalf. We thank you that we are totally healed, made whole, and completely restored, and we give you all the honor, all the glory, and all the praise, in the name above all names, the matchless name of our Lord Jesus the Christ. Amen. Now, did you come expecting this morning to receive from God? Well, if you didn't, then you won't. So get your expectation level elevated, friends, and expect to receive your healing and have it manifest as well as your needs to be met. Amen? Now, if you don't know the words to these songs as we begin our worship service, if you don't know the words, just listen to them, the ones when you can hear these songs, and let them minister to you as we worship and sing. You can look these up on under Google Lyrics and then put in the name of the song, and they'll give you the lyrics, and you can copy them for yourself if you want. All right? I have not been successful in being able to give you the lyrics as well during the broadcast, so that's all I can tell you. We do this for over about a month. We leave the songs up so that you have time to learn them and feel comfortable with them. So anyway, let's get started this morning joyfully, shall we?
Shepherd. captivated, but no longer bound by chains, left at an empty grave, the sinner and the sacred result. And all of creation, sing with me now. Lift up your voice and lay your burden down. And Lord of creation, sing with me now. Fill up the heavens, let His glory reside. Lord of creation, sing with me now. Lift up your voice and lay your burden down. And Lord of creation, sing with me now. Fill up the heavens, let His glory resound.
Sorry, we'll get it right.
Let the weak say I am strong. Let the poor say I am rich. Let the blind say I can see. It's what the Lord has done in me.
Sing Hosanna to his name, folks. Just vamp in it. Dwell in his presence. Praise him. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. Praise your name. Hosanna, Hosanna.
Your feet, I lay me down.
Praise you, Jesus. We worship you this morning. Now stop what you're doing. Pull up a chair and get ready to receive, my friends, because we've entered God's presence with praise and thanksgiving. And now as we dwell in God's presence, we're just going to hang out here. Embrace the sweetness of the Holy Spirit. Bask in his presence and open your hearts to receive him. You know, the power for God's miracles always follows the Word of God, and that's exactly where we're going next, deep into the Word of God. Father, let my words be your words and your words be my words. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, we're moving deeper into the Word of God as we learn about being in Christ. Today we're going to look further as well into the abomination of the Antichrist. Daniel 7, verse 8 refers to the Antichrist when he speaks of another horn or a little one. In prophetic scripture, a horn represents a king of an existing or coming empire. And this prophecy introduces us to a figure, the Antichrist. Now, this person, this Antichrist, will be elevated to a position of authority over 10 nations that arise out of the original Roman Empire. The one whom John called the beast will come to power not by military conquest, my friends, but by the request of the people. As Revelation 17:13 tells us, listen to this, these have one mind and shall give their power and strength unto the beast. He will eventually become the leader of the New World Order. Now, he is going to appear on the world scene in the latter time of Israel's history, according to Revelation 13, verse 1, which tells us this. And I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns 10 crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy. Now, we know that he is a Gentile, because he arises from the sea, which represents the nations of the world, as evidenced in Revelation 17, 15. And he saith unto me, the waters which thou sawest, where the whore sitteth, are peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues. All right, the Antichrist will come from the Roman Empire, since he's a ruler of the people who destroyed Jerusalem, as recorded in Daniel 9:26. Listen to this. And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the prince who shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood. And until the end of the war, desolations are determined. All right, he will be a political leader of a world government with 7 heads and 10 horns, Revelation 13:1. And this means that when he comes to power, there will be, for a short time only, a new world order that has 10 leaders, okay? The Antichrist will conquer 3 of those leaders, and he will wear their crowns. And again, he's emulating Jesus Christ, who is King of kings, all kings, and Lord of all lords. Now, the coming Antichrist will be the ultimate abomination of desolation, because he will introduce himself as God. And the king shall do according to his will, and he shall exalt himself and magnify himself above every god, and shall speak marvelous things against the God of gods, and shall prosper till the indignation be accomplished, for that which is determined shall be done. Neither shall he regard the God of his fathers, nor the desire of women, nor regard any god, for he shall magnify himself above all. Daniel 11:26-37. And there was given unto him a mouth, speaking great things and blasphemies, and power was given unto him to continue 42 months. Revelation 13:5. All right, he's going to demand that the world worship him, and he'll set up his image in Jerusalem and present himself as the Savior of the world. This little horn, this son of perdition, the chief son of Satan, will be anointed to receive demonic power from Satan himself. Wilt thou yet say before him that slayeth thee, I am God? But thou shalt be a man, and no god in the hand of him that slayeth thee. Thou shalt die the deaths of the uncircumcised by the hand of strangers, for I have spoken it, saith the Lord God. Moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, take up the lamentation over the king of Tyre, and say unto him, Thus saith the Lord God, thou sealest up the sum, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. Ezekiel 28:9-12. Now, I know it's short and sweet, but that's what it's about. If you desire to come into and dwell in the miraculous presence of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, if you desire to be in Christ and become bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh, if you wish to avail yourself of his marvelous wisdom, you must give your life to him. You do not want to be fooled by the Antichrist. You do not want to be bamboozled. It's very simple to become born again. It's pain-free, simple. Just repeat this prayer with me. Lord Jesus, I come to you as a sinner, and I surrender my life to you. Take over my life and cleanse me of all unrighteousness. I receive you as my Lord and Savior. I renounce the devil, all sin, Lord. I receive from you the gift of righteousness, total forgiveness of all my sins, past, present, and future. I receive from you divine health, wholeness, and restoration, your protection, direction, your provision, and your peace, and the gift of everlasting life. I am yours. Come into my heart and take over my life. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer with me, then you're saved. Hallelujah. Welcome to the family of God, and rejoice because the blood of Jesus has redeemed you.
Oh, heaven.
Let's talk about love.
Share in this bread of life.
One of the wonderful things that we receive from taking Holy Communion is our healing of our bodies and minds. Now, those who take Holy Communion and don't receive their healing through it will find that it's rooted in lack of knowledge. We must prepare before taking Holy Communion. The first thing that we have to do is this. We need to discern the body of Christ. What does that mean? How do we do that? By acknowledging that the bread or whatever you're using as the body of Christ is the vibrancy of the life of Jesus Christ, his supernatural healing and wholeness. You can think of it as a pill, so just a very small piece of bread or whatever you're using. And it's glowing with the Shekinah glory of God, folks. It's healing you as it travels through your mouth and down into your body. It's pushing out all darkness, which is sickness and disease, from the inside out. Now visualize the condition you're plagued with, the sickness or the disease being on Jesus' body. Put it on him. You then put whatever those ailments are on him. Use your imagination. You're not giving him something he doesn't want. He already took it at the cross, remember? You see, the enemy's trying to trick you. He's trying to trick you into taking it. How? By deceiving you into thinking that you've got it. But since Jesus took it already at the cross, you're healed and made whole already. So put it back on Jesus, right in the same place on him that you've been afflicted. In other words, see yourself with the solution. See yourself without the problem. And this is called spiritual visualization. It's vital you understand it and that you do it. The next thing we do in preparation is discern the blood of Christ. We discern it as the forgiveness of all sin, past, present, and future. As restoration of the blessing to your life, the power and the authority of God in your life in full operation. As receiving the gift of righteousness from Jesus Christ, thanking God for his plan of redemption, that you've been given eternal life, life everlasting, and now you no longer live under the law, but you live under his grace. Now, lift up the elements of the covenant that I asked you to gather before the program got started. I'm going to pray over these, and you just agree with me, but you lift yours up, okay? Father, we praise you and worship you that these elements of the covenant are what you say they are. We thank you that your only begotten Son, Jesus, gave his life sacrificially so that we may live and have life more abundantly. We thank you now as this bread becomes our portion of his healing body and the vibrancy of his life within us. We thank you that as we partake of the body of Christ, we become healed and made whole and completely restored. We thank you that this beverage becomes our portion of his cleansing blood, that we are continually washed in his blood and renewed within as we perpetually remember his act of love on the cross on our behalf. In the name above all names, the matchless name of Jesus the Christ, amen. Now set those elements aside. One more, two or three minutes. I want you to worship, worship with the Lord, soaking in worship as we prepare our hearts to partake of Holy Communion. All right? So I just want you to get in his presence, stay in his presence. This is when you spiritually visualize, okay? Lord's Supper is a personal fellowship. It's actually a partnership with Christ. Partaking of one bread creates partnership between the members as well, and it merges us into one body, the church. This is what Paul was talking about in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 16 through 17, when he asked this, "The cup of the blessing which we bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? For we, though many, are one bread and one body, for we all partake of that one bread. It's a thanks offering of our persons to Christ, who died for us that we might live for him. But it's also an acted sermon, an acted proclamation of the death which it commemorates, to proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Now the word of God commands us to eat the bread and drink the cup. Do this. Perform this action. Continually take bread, give thanks, break it, and eat it in remembrance of Jesus. The Lord commanded that the supper be repeated often. However, in the verse, Paul doesn't really give us any instruction as to how frequently the Lord's Supper is to be celebrated, but he does imply that it's to be done with frequency, so that partaking of the Lord's Supper perpetually recalls to our mind our redemption by Christ from all sickness, all disease, and all sin. So do it as often as you want to and need to. As we're instructed, we discern the body and the blood of Christ as we prepare to partake. On the night that he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The body of our Lord Jesus, broken for you, so that you are and remain healed, made whole, and completely restored. In the name of Jesus the Christ, amen. Father, right now, I just want to lift up Dave to you. Thank you for quelling that cough. Thank you for letting me curse that cancer at the roots. Father, it just has no place in him, and I call it to come out, that spirit of cancer, to come out in the name of Jesus as I partake of your body and blood. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. The blood of our Lord Jesus shed for you for the remission of sins. In the name of Jesus the Christ, amen. Partake of the blood of our Lord and Savior." My friends, the Lord's Supper is a feast. Truly a feast of living union of believers with the Savior, whereby we spiritually and by faith receive Christ with all of his benefits, and we're nourished with the vibrancy of his life into eternal life. And for that, Lord Jesus, we are eternally grateful. Now, one more thing. When we receive Jesus as our Lord and Savior, the Bible tells us that we are made a new creation or new creature in Christ Jesus. The emphasis is on the in Christ Jesus. When we accept Jesus Christ as our Savior, we move into Christ. He surrounds us completely. Now, with that in mind, get this picture. We are in him, and he is in us. Put Jesus on like a suit of clothes. Your hands go in his hands like gloves, your arms into his arms like sleeves on a coat, your body into his body, your legs into his like trousers, and your feet go into his feet. So wherever you go, he goes. Wherever he goes, you go. As a result of this union, all of the vibrancy of his life, all of his divine health and wholeness, all of his perfection are yours. He is in you, and you're in him. Like the caterpillar who moves into a chrysalis and a great exchange takes place supernaturally, he comes forth as a butterfly, never to be a caterpillar again. For the rest of his life, he will remain a butterfly. We too make a great exchange. When we accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we move into Christ. Now, the difference between us and the caterpillar's exchange is this. We are a new creation, but we remain in Christ for all of eternity. Look at the New Testament. All the gifts and promises of God in the New Testament speak about us being in Christ, telling us that we must be in Christ to qualify to receive those gifts and promises. Well, we've also been given the mind of Christ, my friends. Your head goes into Christ's head. You know, in the Old Testament, God promised the Israelites that if they were obedient to his word, he would make them the head and not the tail. But now, when we're a new creation in Christ Jesus and we have been given the mind of Christ, we are the head and we remain the head because the tail is no longer in the equation. You see, we are carried completely in Christ. Therefore, nothing evil can ever touch us. We can't be sick. I know, laugh. Go ahead. Sickness and disease can be offered to us. The enemy can try to get us to take it. How? By coming into agreement with it. Remember in Genesis when God created Adam, the first thing that God did was to bless him? Genesis chapter 2, verses 27 through 28. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And God blessed them. And God said unto them, Be fruitful, and multiply, and replenish the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. That blessing, my friends, was God empowering mankind with his power to accomplish all that he had instructed, that he spoke after that. Replenish the earth, take dominion over the fish, fowl, and everything that moves upon the earth. Satan usurped Adam's power, God's power, and used it for a real long time. When Jesus went to the cross and conquered hell, sin, and death, he triumphed over the devil. He took back all of the power the devil had taken illegally away from Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, and then Jesus restored that power back to us. In other words, he restored us to the blessing. Now, the scriptures tell us that Satan roams about like a roaring lion, looking for whom he may devour. Satan no longer has any power or a bite, my friends. He roars to scare you. These are the things Satan can do since then. He can distract you. What does that mean? He moves your focus off of the things of God onto the cares of this world. He's a past master at it, too. He is wonderful at it. That's his goal. I mean, I know that we've all succumbed to that, where we find ourselves suddenly facing all the worldly things and grumbling and complaining and looking at the negative, when in fact we're not looking for God in everything. The other thing that he can do to you, and the only other thing, is he can deceive you. He is the father of all lies and very cunning in his deceptions. Now, the reality of this, though, is that Satan will always attack you where you lack knowledge of God's word. So if you lack knowledge of what God says about your healing, Satan's going to attack you in your health. If you lack knowledge of Christian finance, Satan will attack you in your finances, in your wallet. His game plan is always the same, distraction and deception. That's all, distraction and deception. So he can't give you anything. He has no power. The only thing he can do is offer it to you, and he does it daily. But from the time you get up in the morning, when you first get up and sit on the edge of the bed and you think, I don't feel very good, or I do feel good, or I feel wonderful, oh wow, this is a great day. He's offering you sickness, disease, despair, depression. How do you react? Do you accept the evil report, receive the sickness and disease, or lack by agreeing with the enemy? Or do you acknowledge the facts? Maybe you do have a pain in your knee or in your shoulder, and that's a fact. But facts are subject to change, my friends, so you agree with what God's word says and promises say about you. I know you're saying to yourself, yeah, but I'm still sick and I'm in pain, and that may be the case, but those are symptoms. You see, the enemy always works from the outside in. God always works from the inside out. Where God is, the enemy cannot be. We aren't denying the symptoms, we're denying their right to be there. Now that we are in Christ Jesus, that is. Because we're totally protected. Because we are in Christ. 1 John chapter 4, verse 17 tells us this, that as Jesus is, so are we in this world. Well, how is Jesus? He's perfect, full of divine health and wholeness, full of the vibrancy of life, able to do miracles, full of confidence in God and his word, and in himself, what he's able to do to accomplish for God. So, as Jesus is, so are we in this world. That belongs to you. Every morning, first thing, begin your day by thanking God for the finished work of Jesus on the cross, and thank him that you are in Christ. Throughout the day, as you think of it, give God glory for all he's already done for you. And again, thank him that you are in Christ. At night, before you retire, give God thanks again for all he is and has done for you as your Savior, and thank him for the power of God that's in your body, coming against all attacks of the devil, keeping you healed and whole. Thank him again that you dwell in the secret place of the Most High, in Christ Jesus. Now, raise your hands for the blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace. May you open up your mouth and continually declare who you are in Christ Jesus, thanking God for all that you've received, and give honor and glory and praise to the Lord Most High. May the Lord continually bless you with divine health and wholeness and make your way prosperous as you walk in his love. Now remember this, my friends, because we are in Christ, as Jesus is, so are we in this world. And I want you to know something. This morning, I fight the same devil you do. This morning when I got up out of bed, I'm telling you, my right knee just shot pains through the back of my leg that I could hardly stand on it. What did I do? whine and cry and say, I don't feel good. Oh, my leg, it hurts. No, I did not. I said, Lord, thank you that the healing power of God is coursing through my body, bathing all those areas that are injured, that want to give me problems. I am not in pain. Why? Because I deny that it's right to be there. I thank you, Lord, that I was healed at the cross, that I am made whole and restored, completely restored in Jesus' name. Because I am in Christ, as Jesus is, so am I in this world, right now. I am pain-free, walking normally, feeling wonderful. Body, line up with the word of God right now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And I thank you, Lord, and give you all the honor, all the glory, and all the praise. In Jesus' name, I am healed, made whole, and I feel wonderful. And you know what? I do. I do. No pain. Now, remember this. Once again, remember it. Because we are in Christ. If you're born again, you are in Christ Jesus. So as Jesus is, so are you in this world. Personalize it. As Jesus is, so am I in this world. Tell the devil you belong to Jesus Christ, because you do. God bless you.